We wanted to know what Gita is saying, what Upanishads are all about. And we used to go to many people, all kind of people, Swamis to Sanskrit scholar to many people. And many a times, by around 2012, people like me have given up reading Indian texts because I thought it is not my cup of tea. So ordinary people like me cannot even think of getting access to this text. Because there are, we used to think that these are very big stuff, I mean, not for ordinary brains that people like me have. And in 2016, Balu started talking to us about some of these texts over phone. A series of conversation happened and we started getting back to Gita. And till then I had packed all these texts that I had purchased and they were all put it in a shelf and I started reopening. And one of the most interesting things happened was startling discoveries of simply reading the text carefully would actually give us so many things that otherwise we would not have noticed. But one of the questions that was troubling people like me is, when I was doing my biology research, things which are so obvious were not obvious when I was reading Gita. So Balu started telling us that you people have not taken Gita as text of knowledge. It is some kind of a textbook. So the way you read biology, you are not reading Gita precisely because you don't think deep down that there is knowledge involved in it. So we started discovering the depth of his comment. And when Balu this time came to India after 2.5 years, decided let's go and sit, instead of giving talks about it, let's go and have classes in the evenings and let's read Gita. And all of us think together and let's see how do we understand, whether ordinary people can understand Gita or not. So we created a heterogeneous group where Arohi students were there and there were Sanskrit scholars who were there and also people generally interested in Gita, but they are not Sanskrit scholars, they were not academicians, all kind of people were there. So we tried reading these texts for about 10 days with him. And it was quite a painful experience because painful in the sense that all that we had assumptions about what these texts are, what some of the concepts are in these texts, were broken down into pieces by simply reading the text. And also we realized that even though we use a lot of things like, you know, Atman, Brahman, Devata, etc., I mean, we really don't seem to be taking them seriously and understanding them, what do they really mean. So Balu actually did something in that process of 10 days. There suddenly we started realizing that, okay, these texts are meant for us and we can also read. You don't need to be a Sanskrit scholar, don't need to be a big philosopher, but these are the texts that I can use and I can connect it to my daily life. So that is the sense that we started realizing after this 10 days of workshop. And then some of us started continue to have this conversation, and for our fortunate, Balu had to extend his 3 weeks trip to 3 months trip. So we had the privilege of going and talking to him and actually asking a lot of questions, sitting and reading with him in some more chapters. And he was raising some more questions using different shlokas of the Gita and also other texts. As a consequence, we thought that we will actually summarize the developments of what we have done so far and discuss with all of you. So in this group now, there are some people who are part of the workshop are there, and there are also people who are generally interested in knowing Indian texts, and there are some who are Balu's students, part of Kuempu University, part of Ujre group, all of them are here. I welcome all of you to this workshop, and Balu would actually sketch more. And I think one of the biggest thing that I have really saw in this 3 months period where Balu was here, what was considered to be a very big thing, what is considered to be something that cannot be comprehended by ordinary people like us, turns out that we can not alone understand, but it is meant for us. And we can actually really read it. And in that process, we can actually raise a lot of interesting questions. One can take the route of doing serious research further into it. And one can also actually start reflecting about oneself and his own society using some of these ideas. So this is what we have learned from the workshop. And in that background, the structure of the workshop has been prepared. And we have sent you the details of the workshop. And three of us, what we have done is we have summarized after Gita classes, what we thought is interesting to discuss. We have put in 3 issues. There are many more issues that we couldn't handle. But 3 issues, we have circulated a note. The presentation will be followed later. So this is what is the workshop is going to be. Structure was already there in the note that I have circulated. Now with this, remark, I will ask Balu to really talk about the workshop and other things.
Namaskara. Thank you. Actually, he has said everything I want. Chaitra has already told you, and as I said, I'll be very brief. What you will now get, first session, first two sessions maybe, is a kind of a summary of what we did in Kannada, the 12 days we studied Gita. So, of course, it will add a few more things that have become clearer after the workshop. So, this is simply a summary of that workshop. And there's a reason why, I will tell you very soon what the reason is, why I'm taking this format. Now, after that, after each presentation, I would suggest we have a discussion on it. Whatever kind of discussion. Question and answers, reactions, when things are not clear, clarificatory questions, whatever. And afterwards, what I thought I would do is, depending on how much time there would be, to take you one step further than the Gita classes. You have got two texts, I think, from Upanishad. We'll sit together and kind of read it. So that you will understand what it is I'm trying to do. I will first tell you what I'm trying to do. Of course, you need to know a lot about my biography, but forget it. I'm a very serious Brahmin who's been trained in Western sciences, okay? In philosophy of science, history of science, sociology of science, anthropology of science, psychology of science, and so on. I'm myself a scientist, did natural sciences in India. Like most of you, because I'm a very orthodox Brahmin, so all I did, I'm sure you will understand it. By the age of 14, I knew the 18 chapters of Gita from top to bottom. I had to recite it every day. My mother said, you must learn it. I learned it. Didn't understand anything, of course, but recited it. And I forgot about all of that in one sense. But the attitude for some time was that these are very difficult texts to understand. Mostly the idea was something very vague, it was never clear. Gita will be properly understood by some special people only. And it is not meant for ordinary people like you and me. And we are ordinary people, right? We are not special, we are not chosen by, well, whatever, God, if you like. So I knew all the shlokas, no? How to do a karma yoga without asking for phala. I knew all that, but didn't know what the hell it meant. What does it mean? Karmanyevadhikaraste maphalesha kadachana. What the hell does that mean? Like one of my students was asking. She had the same problem. If you study for the exams, it's because you want to pass, right? But karmanyevadhikaraste maphalesha kadachana. Don't worry about the result, just study. Well, what the hell does that mean? And my sister gave such a twist on, younger sister, basically, mane kelasthavar barthalala, our karma yogi maanbitlo. It appears everybody is karma yogi. And I didn't know what it was. Kaikave kailasa. Actually, I don't think so. In other words, I heard all these wonderful, daive dharma dhamulayavaya, God knew what the hell it meant. Kaikave kailasa, work is worship. From that kind of great sayings to Sadharmo Nidhanam Sheha Payadharmo Bhayavaha. I didn't know what dharma was, I didn't know what is Sadharma was, I didn't know why the hell should I, what is Bhayavaha in somebody else's dharma, I didn't know that. And nobody could answer it either. So they said, you see, this is all for very intelligent people, very gifted people. Only this is how I was brought up. And I'm sure you have also done it. Open some text of Upanishad or Gita you want to read. And then you all have gone to a commentary, first of all. And commentary immediately begins saying, to understand this shloka, you must understand what Sankhya's notion of Purusha is. I never heard of Sankhya's notion of Purusha. And 5 pages, you haven't understood anything. So you will simply say, this is not for me, right? I think this is more or less your experiences. These are also my experiences. Why is this important? That we know this, these experiences, is because I have been living in Belgium for nearly 40 years and I'm a philosopher, a science, as I told, trained. And I was a Marxist and so on once upon a time. I gave up my life for Marxism to become a professional revolutionary. In case you people want to know what is professional revolutionary, ask me. I can still give a lot of talks about that. Yeah, who was Lenin and what was Gramsci? What's the difference between Luxembourg, Rosa Luxemburg and so on? I can still say that. Wonderful things. No? So, when I went to Marxism, of course, I had tremendous contempt for India. India was a backward country, not modernized, very superstitious, and of course, even though he was a Brahmin, the Brahmins are the basic root cause of poverty in India. So I was an anti-Brahmin. Even tried eating meat. It was very, very painful. 6 months, every day I would eat meat and throw up because I couldn't keep it in my stomach. But you had to do it to prove that you're not a Brahmin. Those days, I don't know how it is now, because you had to be revolutionary, right? Which I was. Left home and all that. So that's the background I had. So, but I was brought up very orthodox Brahmin, but revolted against it. And anyway, it's a long story. Short it is, I, after some time, couple of years, I had very serious intellectual problems with Marxism. So I went to Belgium and I stopped being a Marxist. I still have some respect for Karl Marx intellectually. But I don't think Marxism is any kind of a solution to anything in the world. Not just in India, but fine. In the process, I realized something when I was in Belgium that in some sense I'm an Indian. The problem is, what the hell does it mean to be an Indian? So that started the research process for me. 30 years now, and I'm continuing it even now. It means a lot. So I discovered in a very serious way Indian culture at that stage. What is Indian culture? What makes me an Indian? What differentiates Indian culture from other cultures? What is interesting about the difference? Why bother? Why should we all not become westernized? You do that, no? iPhones, Nike shoes, vegetarian hamburgers. We do that all the time. So why don't you just become westernized? Why bother? I discovered some very, very fascinating answers through my research, scientific research. I discovered that in our culture, in Indian culture, we have developed theories and ideas and research which the whole of mankind needs today. Whole of mankind. And when I say, I mean it in a very serious sense. See, I'm not a nationalist. I'm not a Deshabhakta at all. Absolutely not. Actually, I hate nationalism. It's poison. So, I'm not a nationalist. But I can tell you, on the basis of what I know of sciences, natural sciences, Indians, in the 4,000 years ago, for nearly 1,500 years, developed scientific research on human beings, which is comparable to physics, chemistry, mathematics, genetics, and so on. If physics is scientific, so is Gita, in exactly the same sense. Don't confuse it, because I also have heard some of these people speaking about how India has got science. Atma vidya, brahma vidya, we have to do sadhana, sadhaka. This is absolute nonsense. That's not what I mean. by smoking, by smelling tulsi, you will not become a genius. That is not the science I'm talking about. That's rubbish. There were no supersonic rockets in the time of Ramayana Mahabharata. That's rubbish. That's not what I mean when I say it's science. I really mean it in the very serious sense. If you take a theory of Einstein, or Newton, or Galileo, and ask yourself, is this a scientific theory? You use certain criteria, right? Well, according to those criteria, Gita Upanishad are scientific results. So, in that sense, I've gone back deeper into understanding. Of course, it challenges a lot of orthodoxy. Lots of orthodoxy. And most of the orthodoxy we have been taught as Indian, which is what I discovered, is not Indian at all. Today you will hear about that. From the first chapter of Gita, today they will show you. This is what's happening to us. We have to understand why it has happened, but there's a different issue. So we really don't know about Indian traditions. One of the things I spoke about first chapter in the lessons and talk I gave some time ago was about Varna Sankara. You all know about it, no? Indians are supposed, especially Brahmins, are supposed to be against intercaste marriage, right? First chapter of Gita, Arjuna is supposed to have said it. Brahminical ideology, it is say. Every state in India gives money for intercaste marriages. Hinduism, they say, is based on endogamy. And you have to see to that Brahmins don't marry among Brahmins if you want to break the caste system. These are all stories, you know, no? It's supposed to come from the first chapter. People, it does not. They are a set of lies. Lies. It's not there in the text at all. The opposite is in the text. First chapter of Gita. And I will also talk about Manu, who talks about Varna Sankara. I'll show you how these policies today, these heroes that today who tell you that Hinduism is endogamy and so on, are actually a bunch of liars. Not just in India, in Europe also, in America also. They are not able to read. That's what you're going to see. Read means what? A six-year-old reads. No, that kind of reading they can't do. You will see that today. So this is a problem we face. So anyway, to come back, we'll see some of these problems. We come back. I discovered that there is one thing. Actually, these texts, Gita, Upanishad, they are not ours at all. We have lost them more than 1,000 years. People who interpret it, or not interpreting it, it is not supposed to be interpretation. You don't sit and interpret Einstein's theory of relativity. So you don't interpret Upanishad if it is knowledge, if it is science. I'll talk in greater detail what our problems are, but there's one thing you must remember, which is this. You see, Arjuna, what is the problem? Why do we have difficulties in looking at Gita as something written for us? Why do you look at these big names, and a DVG, or a Shankara, or a Madhva, or a Ramanuja, great acharyas, and some or other Swami Vishwananda from Himalayan thing to tell us what? We do that, no? Why? In some senses, that is what I want you very much to try and fight against. Put Krishna and Arjuna in our midst. That is, look at them, what they were. Even if Krishna is Aparavatara, Vishnu, without questioning it, without confirming it, Krishna lived, Arjuna lived, according to the stories at least. So put them here, in today's world. Meaning what? Don't bother what Mahabharata said about the age of Arjuna. He would have been about 35-40. Why 35-40? His son Abhimanyu was 16 years old, so if he has a kid of 16, he must have produced it, what, 18, 20 years old when he had a child. So he was 35, 40 years old. 12 years he had 1 year Ajnatavasa, 11 year Vanavasa. So 28 when he kicked out of Hastinapura. So which means basically he was learning in those 28 years. What was he learning? Learning how to fight, learning how to read and write, and chasing after women after a certain age. You know that Arjuna chased after a lot of women, got into a lot of problems also. Make him an ordinary human being like us. Okay? Then get upset by that. Which means, basically, so this guy is in war, in a battlefield. Krishna is speaking to him. Arjuna is not a philosopher. Arjuna could not have been a jnani. Please don't think that. This is the mistake we make. Arjuna was an ordinary warrior. Some kind of a sergeant in the army. Krishna is speaking to him orally. He doesn't know physics, he doesn't know biology, he doesn't know logic, doesn't know metaphysics, doesn't know ontology, had never heard of Sankhya, Purusha and so on, nothing. Make him a person like that, one of us, and ask yourself this question. Krishna said it so that Arjuna could understand. Did Arjuna understand it? He seems to have, because he asks questions about things he did not understand. Your conclusion must be only one. If Arjuna could understand Gita, people, you and I can also understand Gita. Without commentaries, without DVGs, without the great acharyas, without Sankhya notion of Purusha. No, meant for you and me. Keep this in mind. Not only Gita, Upanishad, the same thing. And that is one of the most fantastic things about India, is that one day, hopefully I can tell you, show you how they made knowledge accessible to ordinary people, illiterate peasants. What does it mean accessible? You see, if you look at the world today, as how little Indians we are, we reproduce talk of Americans and Europeans. Namely, science must be popularized. Yeah? Science must be dumbed down. Science must be made simple. We all agree, we must write popular science textbooks. You can't be more stupid than that. Why? You see, you can't simplify knowledge. You can't popularize knowledge. You can't dumb down knowledge. Because if you do that, what you'll be teaching is ignorance, not knowledge. So knowledge, if it has to reach the people, cannot be popularized. But knowledge can be transmitted, can be taught in such a way that everybody understands. And that is the extraordinary thing that Indian culture has done. Extraordinary. I know no culture in the world which has done that. Therefore, what I'm saying is, these Upanishads, these Brahma Sutras, though there's only one, this Gita can be understood by you without any expert commentaries, because it is science of human beings. It is knowledge in that sense. It's science of who you and I are. It's about our psychology. Western psychology is a load of rubbish compared to Gita. 4,000 years ago, 3,500 years, 3,000 years ago, our psychology is light years ahead of cognitive science, artificial intelligence, any psychology you like to think of. So therefore you will understand. And that's why there are some people in the audience. Which means, to understand this, you don't have to be a Hindu. Rubbish. To understand physics, you don't have to be a Hindu. Hindus can understand it. Christians can understand it. Muslims can understand it. Europeans can understand it. Indians have no special access to Gita Upanishad. That's nonsense. Because this is knowledge. is accessible to everyone. Second, there are people who say, you must know Sanskrit. Ask yourself the following question. You don't even know it. Do you need to know Latin to understand Newton? You know why? Because Newton wrote his book, Principia Naturalis, in Latin. Do you need to know Latin to learn Newtonian physics? Do you need German to understand Einstein? Do you need Dutch to understand Anton van Leeuwenhoek? You don't. In exactly the same way, you don't need Sanskrit to understand the Gita, the Upanishad, the Brahma Sutra, nothing. You don't need it. You need translations. Maybe there's some problems with translations. We discuss that. So you must be, only Hindus have this rubbish. Christians and Muslims, there are some here in the audience. I brought them. They don't know Sanskrit. I promise them. You don't have to know Sanskrit. You don't have to be a Hindu, whatever that means. But Gita is accessible to you also. Same thing about Europeans. So don't romanticize Indians. There's some deep insight into Adhyatma. That's rubbish. Some people have said it. And then I hope they will change their minds. So this workshop, keep this in mind. Keep it, at least take that lesson. It's meant for you. The Gita, the Upanishad, the Brahma Sutra, all the Indian texts. Not just the 13 principal Upanishad, all the 108. And you can understand them because they are sciences. So, don't worry about it. In a way, I hope, at the end of the two-day session, you will at least feel this, namely, these are your texts. These are written for you. And these experts, drop them. Don't touch them. They don't know what they are talking about. I will show you that. Okay? So, I'll stop here. So, please, this is basically to what we in English call empowerment. You have to feel empowered. The Gita is yours. Nobody can take it from you. And you will understand it. You don't need big experts to teach you. No. Only thing is, take it seriously. That's all. Read it seriously. That's all. And I'll promise you, you will. By the end of today, you will have understood more things than many specialists. I promise you that. No interpretations. We won't give you interpretations. Simply show you the text. Okay? So, this is an experiment because I just retired last October. And I'm wondering what I should be doing in the next 2-3 years that are left to me on this earth. I've been 40 years I've been working. I want to transmit this knowledge to those who need it most. So I'm thinking of spending quite a long time from next year onwards, 6 to 8 months in India, doing different kinds of things. No talks and so on. I won't give any more public talks, but I'll give sessions and training sessions and so on, reading sessions. So this is an experiment for me. And if you feel that, oh, I have a feeling I understand something, I have succeeded. So before we continue, there's just one thing we had agreed, that 4 people from that 12-day Canada session we had on Gita would very briefly come and tell us, it'll be the first time for me also to hear them, about their experience of what these 12 days were. Was it good, was it bad, was it useful, whatever it is. I don't know what they're going to say. Okay? Any questions?
So now I request Vinayak Hampihole to say what he thought about the workshop. He spent all the time with us when we read Gita.
Hello. Okay, Kannadadalli. Aarambhadalli Balu avara ondu ವಿಚಾರಗಳಿಗೆ ಗೀತೆಯನ್ನು ಅವರು ಶುರು ಮಾಡಿದಾಗ ಅವ್ರು ಹೇಳೋದಕ್ಕೆ ನಾನು ಹೊಂದ್ಕೊಳ್ಳೋದು ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಕಷ್ಟ ಆಗ್ತಿತ್ತು. ಅದರಲ್ಲೂ ಅವರು ದುರ್ಯೋಧನನ ಭಾಷೆ ಮತ್ತು ಅರ್ಜುನನ ಭಾಷೆಯನ್ನು ಅವರು ಕಂಪೇರ್ ಮಾಡಿ ಹೇಳುವಾಗಂತೂ ಒಂದು ಕಸಿವಿಸಿ ಆಗ್ತಾ ಇತ್ತು. ಯಾವ ಒಂದು ವಾರದ ಹೊತ್ತಿಗೆ ಒಂದು ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಏನೋ ಅರ್ಥ ಆಗೋದಕ್ಕೆ ಶುರುವಾಯಿತು. ಮುಂಚಿಂದನೂ ಭಗವದ್ಗೀತೆ ಅರ್ಥ ಮಾಡ್ಕೋಬೇಕು ಅರ್ಥ ಮಾಡ್ಕೋಬೇಕು ಅಂತ ಹೊರಟಿದ್ದು ನನಗೆ. ಬಾಲೂರು ಬದಲಿಸಿದ ರೀತಿ ಏನಂದರೆ, ಭಗವದ್ಗೀತೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಬರೋ ಒಂದು ಶ್ಲೋಕಗಳ ವಿಷಯಗಳ ಕುರಿತು ನಾವು ಏನು ಪ್ರಶ್ನೆ ಮಾಡ್ಕೋಬಹುದು ಅನ್ನೋದನ್ನು ಒಂದು ಅದು ಒಂದು ಅರ್ಥ ಆಯಿತು. ಮತ್ತು ಅಶ್ವಿನಿಯವರು ನೀವು ನಿಮ್ಮ ಅಭಿಪ್ರಾಯಗಳನ್ನು ತಿಳಿಸಿ ಅಂದಾಗ ನಾವು ಒಪ್ಕೊಳ್ಳೋದಕ್ಕೆ ಮುಖ್ಯ ಕಾರಣ ಇದು ತಪ್ಪಿದ್ರೆ ನೀವು ತಿದ್ದಬಹುದು ಅಂತ. ಅದಕ್ಕೋಸ್ಕರನೇ ನಾನು ಇದನ್ನು ಒಪ್ಕೊಂಡೆ. ಇವರು ಕೃಪೆ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಹೇಳಿದಾಗ ನಾನು ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ವಾದ ಮಾಡಿದ ನಂತರ ನಾನು ಒಪ್ಕೊಂಡೆ ಅವರ ವ್ಯೂಸ್ ಏನಿದೆ ಕೃಪೆ ಅನ್ನೋ ಶಬ್ದದ ಬಗ್ಗೆ. ಅದು ಒಪ್ಕೊಳ್ಬೇಕಾಯಿತು ಯಾಕೆ ಅಂತಂದರೆ, ಭಗವದ್ಗೀತೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಕೃಪೆ ಅನ್ನೋ ಶಬ್ದ ಹೇಗೆ ಪ್ರಯೋಗ ಆಗಿದೆ, ಶಂಕರಾಚಾರ್ಯ ಭಾಷ್ಯದಲ್ಲಿ ಹೇಗೆ ಪ್ರಯೋಗ ಆಗಿದೆ, ಆ ವ್ಯತ್ಯಾಸ ನನ್ನನ್ನು ಒಪ್ಕೊಳ್ಳೋ ಹಾಗೆ ಮಾಡಿಬಿಡ್ತು. ವರ್ಣಸಂಕರದ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ನನಗೆ ಇಡೀ ಒಂದು ಗೊಂದಲ ಇಡೀ ಒಂದು ಭಗವದ್ಗೀತೆಯನ್ನು ಓದುವಾಗ ಇದ್ದೇ ಇತ್ತು. ಆದರೆ ಆನಂತರ ಭಗವದ್ಗೀತೆಯನ್ನು ಹಾಗೆ ಮುಂದೋದುವಾಗ ಕೃಷ್ಣ ಆ ಶಬ್ದವನ್ನು ಶಂಕರ ಶಬ್ದವನ್ನು ಬಳಸಿದ್ದು ನೋಡಿದಾಗ ಇವ್ರ ಮಾತಲ್ಲಿ ಏನೋ ಒಂದು ಪಾಯಿಂಟ್ ಇದೆ ಅಂತ ಅನಿಸಿತ್ತು. ಇವತ್ತು ನೀವು ಬುಕ್ ಇದನ್ನು ಕೊಟ್ಟಾಗ, ನೀವು ಬುಕ್ಲೆಟ್ ಕೊಟ್ಟಾಗ ಓದುವಾಗ, ಟು ಬಿ ಫ್ರ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಐ ಆಮ್ ಬೈಯಿಂಗ್ ಯುವರ್ ಆರ್ಗ್ಯುಮೆಂಟ್ ಟುಡೇ ಕಂಪ್ಲೀಟ್ಲಿ, ಸೊ ಟು ಬಿ ಆನೆಸ್ಟ್. ಆದರೆ ಇಷ್ಟೊಂದು ಸ್ವಚ್ಛಂದವಾಗಿ ವಿಚಾರ ಮಾಡೋದಕ್ಕೆ ಮತ್ತು ಪ್ರಶ್ನೆ ಕೇಳೋದಕ್ಕೆ ಅವಕಾಶ ಅಂತ ಅವರು ತುಂಬ ಕೊಟ್ಟಿದ್ದರು. ಸೊ ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ಸ್ ಟು ಯು. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಈ ರೀತಿಯ ಒಂದು ಸೆಷನ್ಗಳು ಮತ್ತೆ ಮತ್ತೆ ಆಗ್ತಿದ್ದರೆ ನಮಗೂ ತುಂಬ ಅನುಕೂಲ. ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು.
ಎಲ್ರಿಗೂ ನಮಸ್ಕಾರ. ನನ್ನ ಹೆಸರು ನಟೇಶ ಅಂಥೇಳಿ, ನಾನು ಸಂಸ್ಕೃತ ಪಾಠ ಮಾಡ್ತೀನಿ ಜೈನ್ ಯೂನಿವರ್ಸಿಟಿಯಲ್ಲಿ. ಹಾಗೆ ನಾನು ಸಂಸ್ಕೃತ ಆರಂಭ ಮಾಡಿ ಸುಮಾರು 20 ವರ್ಷ ಆಯಿತು. ನಮಗೊಂದು ಮಾರ್ಗ ಹಾಕ್ಕೊಟ್ಟಿದ್ದಾರೆ, ನೀವು ಈ ಥರದಲ್ಲಿ ಓದಬೇಕು ಅಂತ. ಸಂಸ್ಕೃತ ಆರಂಭದಲ್ಲಿ ಸಂಸ್ಕೃತವನ್ನು ಕಲ್ತ್ಕೊಂಡಿದ್ದೀವಿ. ಸಂಸ್ಕೃತ ಆರಂಭ ಮಾಡಿಕೊಂಡು ಕೆಲವೊಂದಷ್ಟು ಪ್ರಕರಣ ಗ್ರಂಥಗಳು ಅಂತ ನಾವು ಸಂಸ್ಕೃತದಲ್ಲಿ ಹೇಳ್ತೀವಿ, ಅದನ್ನು ಅಭ್ಯಾಸ ಮಾಡಿಕೊಂಡ್ಮೇಲೆ ನಾವು ಗೀತಾ ಗ್ರಂಥವನ್ನು ಓದಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಆರಂಭ ಮಾಡ್ತೀವಿ. ಆ ಮಾರ್ಗದಲ್ಲಿ ಬಂದಾಗ ಅದು ನಮಗೆ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಏನು ನಾವು ಓದಿದ್ದೀವೋ ಅದೆಲ್ಲವೂ ಕೂಡ ಒಂದು 50% ನಮಗೆ ಅದು ಅರ್ಥ ಆಗಿದೆ. ಅದರಿಂದ ನಮಗೆ ಒಂದು ಖುಷಿ ಇದೆ, ನಾವು ಓದಿದ್ದೀವಿ ಅನ್ನುವಂಥ ಒಂದು ಖುಷಿ ಇದೆ. ಆದರೆ ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಬಂದು ನಾವು ಓದಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಶುರು ಮಾಡಿದಾಗ ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಕೇಳ್ತಾ ಇರುವಂತಹ ಪ್ರಶ್ನೆಗಳು, ನಾನು ಮೊದಲು ಓದುವಾಗ ಅದು ಯಾವ ಪ್ರಶ್ನೆಗಳು ಕೂಡ ಬಂದಿರಲಿಲ್ಲ. ಯಾಕೆಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರೆ ನಮಗೆ ಆ ಕ್ರಮದಲ್ಲಿ ಹೇಳ್ಕೊಟ್ಟಿದ್ದಾರೆ, ನಿಮ್ಗೆ ಈ ಥರನೇ ಓದಬೇಕು, ಈ ಥರದಲ್ಲೇ ಓದಬೇಕು ಅನ್ನೋದನ್ನು ಹೇಳ್ಕೊಟ್ಟಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ನಾವು ಆ ಥರದಲ್ಲಿ ಹೋದಾಗ ನಮ್ಗೆ ಅಂತಹ ಪ್ರಶ್ನೆಗಳು ಬರೋದಿಲ್ಲ, ಅಥವಾ ನಾನು ಕೇಳ್ಕೊಂಡಿಲ್ಲ ಆ ಥರನೂ ಇಟ್ಕೊಂಡು ನಾನು ಕೇಳ್ಕೊಂಡಿಲ್ಲ ಅಂತಹ ಪ್ರಶ್ನೆಗಳನ್ನು. ಭಗವದ್ಗೀತೆ ಮೊದಲನೇ ಅಧ್ಯಾಯದಲ್ಲಿ ಕೆಲವೊಂದಷ್ಟು ಪ್ರಶ್ನೆಗಳನ್ನು ತಗೊಂಡು ನಾವು ಬಾಲುವರ ಜೊತೆಗೆ ಸುಮಾರು 10 ದಿವಸ ಅಭ್ಯಾಸ ಮಾಡಿದಾಗ ಒಂದನ್ಸಿದ್ದೆ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರೆ, ನಾವು ಇಂಥ ಪ್ರಶ್ನೆಗಳನ್ನು ಕೇಳ್ಕೊಳ್ಳೋದ್ರಲ್ಲಿ ನಾವು ಸೋತಿದ್ದೀವಿ ಅಂತ ಮೊದಲನೇದು. ಎರಡನೇದು, ಈ ಪ್ರಶ್ನೆಗಳನ್ನು ಉತ್ತರ ಹುಡ್ಕೊಳ್ಳೋಕೆ ಹೋದಾಗ ನಾವು ನಮ್ಮ ಯಾವುದೇ ಟೆಕ್ಸ್ಟಿನ ಇನ್ಯಾವುದೋ ರೆಫರೆನ್ಸ್ ಎತ್ಕೊಂಬಂದು ಯಾವುದೇ ರೀತಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ನಾವು ನಮ್ಮ ಉತ್ತರವನ್ನು ಕೊಟ್ಟರು ಕೂಡ ಅದು ಸಾಕಾಗ್ತಾ ಇರಲಿಲ್ಲ. ಯಾವುದನ್ನು ಹೇಳಿದ್ರು ಕೂಡ ಇಲ್ಲ, ಹಾಗಾದ್ರೆ ಇದು ಹೇಳಿ, ಅದು ಹೇಳಿ, ಇನ್ನೊಂದು ಹೇಳಿ, ಮತ್ತೊಂದು ಹೇಳಿ, ನಮಗೆ ಗೊತ್ತಿರೋದು ತುಂಬ ಕಡಿಮೆ. ಅದರಲ್ಲಿ ಯಾವುದೇ ರೀತಿಯ ಉತ್ತರ, ಉದಾಹರಣೆ ಕೃಪೆ ಅನ್ನೋ ವಿಷಯದಲ್ಲಿ ನಮಗೆ ಗೊತ್ತಿರುವಂತಹ ಎಲ್ಲ ರೆಫರೆನ್ಸ್ ಇಟ್ಕೊಂಡು ನಮ್ಮ ವ್ಯಾಖ್ಯಾನ ನಾವು ಮಾಡಿದ್ವಿ. ಹಾಗಾದರೆ ಅವ್ರು ಕೇಳುವಂತಹ ಪ್ರಶ್ನೆಗಳಿಗೆ, ಕೆಲವೊಂದಷ್ಟು ಪ್ರಶ್ನೆಗಳಿಗೆ ನಮಗೆ ಉತ್ತರ ಕೊಡೋಕ್ಕಾಗಲ್ಲ. ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಕಾರಣ ಒಂದಷ್ಟು, ಒಂದು ವಿಷಯ ಏನಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರೆ ನಾವು ಸೈನ್ಸ್ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿ ಆ ಬ್ಯಾಕ್ಗ್ರೌಂಡಿಂದ ನಾವು ಓದ್ಕೊಂಡಿಲ್ಲ. ನಾವು ನಮ್ಮದೇ ಆದಂತಹ ಕೆಲವೊಂದು ಬ್ಯಾಕ್ಗ್ರೌಂಡಿಂದ ನಾವು ಓದ್ಕೊಂಡಿದ್ದೀವಿ, ಅದೊಂದು ಸಮಸ್ಯೆ ಇದ್ದೇ ಇದೆ. ಜೊತೆಗೆ ನಮಗೆ ಸರಿಯಾಗಿ ಪ್ರಶ್ನೆ ಕೇಳ್ಕೊಳಕ್ಕೆ ಬರಲಿಲ್ಲ, ಅಥವಾ ನಾವು ಉತ್ತರ ಹುಡ್ಕೊಳ್ಳೋದ್ರಲ್ಲಿ ನಾವು ಎಡವಿದ್ದೀವಿ, ನಾವು ಸರಿಯಾದ ರೀತಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ಅವ್ರನ್ನ ಪ್ರಶ್ನೆ ಕೇಳ್ಕೊಂಡು ಮುಂದೆ ಹೋಗಿರಲಿಲ್ಲ ಅನ್ನುವಂಥ ಭಾವನೆ ಸುಮಾರು ಆಲ್ಮೋಸ್ಟ್ ಆ 10 ದಿವಸದಲ್ಲೂ ನನಗೆ ಅನಿಸಿರೋದು. ಒಂದು ಹಂತದವರೆಗೆ ಅಥವಾ ಒಂದು ಹಂತಕ್ಕೆ ಅಂದರೆ ಅಥವಾ ಈಗಿನ ಪರಿಸ್ಥಿತಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ಹೇಳೋದಾದರೆ, ಇಷ್ಟು ಕೇಳ್ಕೊಂಡಿರುವಂಥ ಪ್ರಶ್ನೆಗಳಿಗೆ, ಒಂದು 7-8 ವಿಷಯಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಕೇಳ್ಕೊಂಡಿರುವಂಥ ಪ್ರಶ್ನೆಗಳಿಗೆ ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಈ ಒಂದು ವೇದಿಕೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಏನು ಚಿಂತನೆ ಆಗಿದೆಯೋ ಅದು ಕನ್ವಿನ್ಸಿಂಗ್ ಆಗಿದೆ, ಅದನ್ನು ಸರಿ ಒಪ್ಕೊಳ್ಬಹುದು, ಇದು ಅರ್ಥ ಆಗೋ ಥರ ಇದೆ, ಸರಿಯಾಗಿದೆ, ಇದೇ ಕ್ರಮದಲ್ಲಿ ಅರ್ಥ ಮಾಡ್ಕೊಳ್ಳೋದು ಚೆನ್ನಾಗಿದೆ ಅಂಥೇಳಿ ನಮಗೆ ಅದನ್ನು ಮನವರಿಕೆ ಮಾಡಿಕೊಡುತ್ತೆ. ಇದೇ ಮಾರ್ಗದಲ್ಲೇ ಇನ್ನೂ ಸಾಕಷ್ಟು ದೂರ ಹೋಗಲಿಕ್ಕಿದೆ, ತುಂಬ ಅಧ್ಯಯನ ಮಾಡಲಿಕ್ಕಿದೆ, ತುಂಬ ಇದೊಂದು ಏನಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರೆ ನಾಂದಿ ಥರ ಅಷ್ಟೇ, ಇದೊಂದು ಆರಂಭ ಅಷ್ಟೇ. ಈ ಆರಂಭ ಆಗಿರೋದು ತುಂಬ ದೂರದಲ್ಲಿ ಹೋಗಬೇಕಾಗಿದೆ, ಬಹಳಷ್ಟು ದೂರ ಕ್ರಮಿಸಬೇಕಾಗಿದೆ. ಆ ಮಾರ್ಗದಲ್ಲಿ ಇನ್ನೂ ಸಾಕಷ್ಟು ಚಿಂತನೆಗಳು ಬರಲಿ, ಇನ್ನೊಂದಷ್ಟು ಇದೇ ಮಾರ್ಗದಲ್ಲಿ ಮುಂದುವರಿಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಸಾಕಷ್ಟು ಅವಕಾಶಗಳು ಉಂಟಾಗಲಿ ಅಂಥೇಳಿ, ಆ ಥರ ಅವಕಾಶಗಳು ಬರಲಿ ಅಂಥೇಳಿ ಒಂದು ಆಸೆ ಬಂದಿದೆ, ಅಥವಾ ಆ ಥರ ಒಂದು ಮನಸ್ಸಿಗೆ ಅನಿಸಿದೆ ಅನ್ನೋದೇ ಈ ವರ್ಕ್ಶಾಪಿನ ಒಂದು ಫೀಡ್ಬ್ಯಾಕ್ ಅಂತ. ನಮಸ್ಕಾರ.
ಮೀನಾಕ್ಷಿ,
ಎಲ್ಲರಿಗೂ ನಮಸ್ಕಾರ. ನನ್ನ ಹೆಸರು ಮೀನಾಕ್ಷಿ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಐ ಆಮ್ ವೆರಿ ಪ್ರಿವಿಲೇಜ್ಡ್ ಟು ಬಿ ಅಸೋಸಿಯೇಟೆಡ್ ವಿತ್ ದ ಆರೋಹಿ ಗ್ರೂಪ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಐ ಆಮ್ ವೆರಿ ಹ್ಯಾಪಿ ದ್ಯಾಟ್ ಐ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಅಟೆಂಡೆಡ್ ದ ಗೀತಾ ರೀಡಿಂಗ್ ಸೆಷನ್ಸ್. ಅದೊಂದು ಥರದ ಸಮಾಧಾನವನ್ನು ಕೊಟ್ಟಿದೆ. ಪ್ಲಸ್ ಗೀತೆಯನ್ನು ಅಫ್ಕೋರ್ಸ್ ನಾವು ಸಣ್ಣ ಮಕ್ಕಳಿದ್ದಾಗಿಂದ ಕೇಳಿದ್ದು ಒಂದು ರೀತಿಯಾದಂಥ ಒಂದು ಪ್ರವಚನಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಅಥವಾ ಬೇರೆ ಯಾವುದೋ ಒಂದು ಗೀತೆಯನ್ನು ಹೇಗೆ ಓದಬೇಕು ಅಥವಾ ಅಲ್ಲಿರುವಂತಹ ಒಂದು ಅರ್ಥವನ್ನು ತಿಳ್ಕೊಳ್ಳೋಕ್ಕೆ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಕೊಟ್ಟಿರುವಂತಹ ಟ್ರಾನ್ಸ್ಲೇಷನ್ ಅಂತ ಏನಿದೆ ಅದನ್ನು ಓದೋವಂಥದ್ದು, ಬರೀ ಇಷ್ಟರಲ್ಲೇ ನಾವು ಇದ್ದಿದ್ದು ಅಥವಾ ಶ್ಲೋಕಗಳನ್ನ ಕಲಿಯೋದು ಬರೀ ಇಷ್ಟನ್ನೇ ನಾವು ಡೆವಲಪ್ ಮಾಡಿಕೊಂಡಿದ್ದರಿಂದ ಗೀತೆ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಅಷ್ಟೊಂದಾಗಿ ನಾನು ಯಾವತ್ತೂ ಸೀರಿಯಸ್ ಆಗಿ ಥಿಂಕ್ ಮಾಡಿರಲಿಲ್ಲ. ಬಟ್ ಯಾವಾಗ ನಾನು ಬಾಲು ಅವರ ರೀಡಿಂಗ್ ಸೆಷನ್ ಅಟೆಂಡ್ ಮಾಡಿದ್ಮೇಲೆ ನನಗೆ ಪೂರ್ತಿಯಾಗಿ ಅನಿಸ್ಬಿಟ್ಟಿದೆ ಗೀತೆನ ಪೂರ್ತಿಯಾಗಿ ಓದಬೇಕು ಅಂತ. ಸೊ ಇಟ್ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ಗಿವನ್ ಮೀ ಲಾಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಸ್ಯಾಟಿಸ್ಫ್ಯಾಕ್ಷನ್. ಸೊ ಬಾಲು ಅವರು ಯಾವತ್ತೋ ಒಂದು ದಿವಸ ಕೇಳಿದರು, ಆರ್ ಯು ಸ್ಯಾಟಿಸ್ಫೈಡ್ ಅನ್ನೋ ಒಂದು ಪ್ರಶ್ನೆಯನ್ನು ಕೇಳಿದರು ನನಗೆ ಆ ಸೆಷನ್ ಮುಗಿದ ಮೇಲೆ. ಸೊ ನಾನಿವತ್ತು ಹೇಳ್ತೀನಿ, ಐ ಆಮ್ ನಾಟ್ ಸ್ಯಾಟಿಸ್ಫೈಡ್, ಐ ವಾಂಟ್ ಟು ರೀಡ್ ದ ಫುಲ್ ಥಿಂಗ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಐ ವಾಂಟ್ ಟು ಗೇನ್ ದ್ಯಾಟ್ ನಾಲೆಜ್. ಸೊ ನಾನು ಹರಿದಾಸರ ಬರೆದಿರುವಂಥ ಕೃತಿಗಳಿರ್ಬೋದು ಅಥವಾ ಕಬೀರ್ ತುಳಸಿದಾಸ್ ಬರೆದಿರುವಂತಹ ಕೃತಿಗಳಿರ್ಬೋದು, ಅದನ್ನೆಲ್ಲ ಓದಿದಾಗ ಅವರು ಹಲವಾರು ಕಡೆಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಕೃಪೆ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಮಾತಾಡಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ತಮ್ಮ ಕೃತಿಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಕೃಪೆ ಅನ್ನುವಂಥ ಒಂದು ಶಬ್ದ ಅಥವಾ ದಯೆ ಅನ್ನುವಂಥ ಒಂದು ಶಬ್ದವನ್ನು ಪ್ರಯೋಗ ಮಾಡಿದ್ದಾರೆ ಅಥವಾ ಬಳಸಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಸೊ ಈ ಥರದ್ದು ಒಂದು ನನಗೆ ಎಲ್ಲಿಂದ ಬರ್ತಾ ಇದೆ ಅಥವಾ ಎಲ್ಲಿಂದ ಯಾತಕ್ಕೆ ಇದನ್ನು ಯೂಸ್ ಮಾಡಿದ್ದಾರೆ ಅನ್ನುವಂಥ ಒಂದು ಪ್ರಶ್ನೆ ಅಂತ ತಗೊಂಡಾಗ ಗೀತೆನಲ್ಲಿ ನಾವು ಓದಬೇಕಾದ್ರೆ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಒಂದು ಮೊದಲನೇ ಅಧ್ಯಾಯದಲ್ಲಿ 27 ಶ್ಲೋಕದಲ್ಲಿ ಒಂದು ಬರುತ್ತೆ, ಕೃಪೆಯ ಪರಯ ವಿಶ್ವ ಅನ್ನುವಂಥ ಒಂದು ಸಾಲು ಬರುತ್ತೆ. ಆ ಸಾಲಲ್ಲಿ ಕೃಷ್ಣ ಹೇಳ್ತಾ ಇರೋದು ಕೃಪೆ ಅನ್ನೋದು ಇಸ್ ನಾಟ್ ಅ ವರ್ಚ್ಯೂ ಅನ್ನುವಂಥ ಒಂದು ಪಾಯಿಂಟ್. ಸೊ ಹಾಗಾದರೆ ಈ ದಾಸರು ಅಥವಾ ಬೇರೆ ಯಾರೇ ಭಕ್ತಿ ಪಂಥರಿರ್ಬೋದು ಯಾತಕ್ಕೆ ಇದನ್ನು ಉಪಯೋಗಿಸ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ, ದಯೆ ಕಾರುಣ್ಯ ದಯಾ ಕೃಪಾ ಅನ್ನೋದನ್ನು ಯಾತಕ್ಕೆ ಉಪಯೋಗಿಸ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ ಅಥವಾ ಹೇಗೆ ಇದು ಅದು ಒಂದು ವರ್ಚ್ಯೂ ಅಲ್ಲ ಅಂತ ಗೀತೆ ಓದಿದ ಮೇಲೆ ಗೊತ್ತಾದಾಗ ಇದು ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಯಾಕೆ ಈ ಥರದ್ದು ಒಂದು ಇದನ್ನು ಈ ರೀತಿಯಾಗಿ ಯಾಕೆ ಬಳಸ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ ಅನ್ನುವಂಥ ಒಂದು ಪ್ರಶ್ನೆ ಬಂದು. ಸೊ ಈ ಥರದ ಕೆಲವೊಂದು ಪ್ರಶ್ನೆಗಳಿಗೆ ನನಗೆ ಉತ್ತರಗಳು ಗೀತೆಯಿಂದ ಕೂಡ ಸಿಕ್ಕಿದೆ. ಸೊ ನನಗೆ ಅನಿಸಿದ್ದೇನು ಅಂದರೆ ಗೀತೆಯನ್ನು ಹೇಗೆ ಆ್ಯಸ್ ಅ ಟೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ ಓದಬೇಕು ಅನ್ನೋದು ಗೊತ್ತಾದರೆ ಪ್ರಾಬಬ್ಲಿ ನಾವು ಎಲ್ಲ ಬೇರೆ ತರಹದ ಒಂದು ಆಧ್ಯಾತ್ಮಿಕ ಟ್ರೆಡಿಷನ್ಸ್ ಇರ್ಬೋದು ಅಥವಾ ಉಪನಿಷತ್ಸ್ ಇರ್ಬೋದು ಇನ್ನು ಕ್ಲಿಯರ್ ಆಗಿ ನಮಗೆ ಅರ್ಥ ಆಗ್ಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಸುಲಭ ಆಗತ್ತೆ ಅನ್ನೋದು ನನಗೆ ಗೊತ್ತಾಯ್ತು. ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು.
ಎನಿವೇ ಚೇತನ್,
ವೆನ್ ಐ ವಾಸ್ ಅಪ್ರೋಚ್ಡ್ ಟು ಕಮ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಅಟೆಂಡ್ ದಿಸ್ ಸೆಷನ್, ಐ ವಾಸ್ ಥಿಂಕಿಂಗ್ ದಟ್ ಐ ವಾಸ್ ದ ಆಡ್ ಮ್ಯಾನ್ ಔಟ್ ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ಐ ಕಮ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ಸೈನ್ಸ್ ಬ್ಯಾಕ್ಗ್ರೌಂಡ್. ಅಂಡ್ ದಿಸ್ ಒನ್ ವೀಕ್ ವೇರ್ ಐ ಅಟೆಂಡೆಡ್, ಐ ವಾಸ್ ದ ಮೋಸ್ಟ್ ಪ್ರಾಬಬ್ಲಿ ದ ಹ್ಯಾಪಿಯೆಸ್ಟ್ ಪರ್ಸನ್ ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ವಾಟ್ ಎವರ್ ಹೀ ಸ್ಪೋಕ್ ವಾಸ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ದ ಸೈಂಟಿಫಿಕ್ ಪರ್ಸ್ಪೆಕ್ಟಿವ್. ಅಂಡ್ ನೆವರ್ ಡಿಡ್ ಐ ರಿಯಲೈಸ್ ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ವಿ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ವನ್ ಮೆನಿ ಕಾಂಪಿಟೇಷನ್ಸ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಮೈ ಸೆಲ್ಫ್ ಹ್ಯಾವಿಂಗ್ ವನ್ ದ ಫಸ್ಟ್ ಪ್ರೈಸ್ ಇನ್ ವಾಟ್ ಎವರ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಐ ಗಾಟ್ ಭಗವದ್ಗೀತ ಆಸ್ ಒನ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಬುಕ್ಸ್, ಐ ನೆವರ್ ಥಾಟ್ ದ್ಯಾಟ್ ಯುನೋ ಭಗವದ್ಗೀತ ಕುಡ್ ಬಿ ರೆಡ್ ಲೈಕ್ ದಿಸ್ ಫಾರ್ ಅ ವೆರಿ ಸಿಂಪಲ್ ರೀಸನ್ ದ್ಯಾಟ್ ಯುನೋ ಭಗವದ್ಗೀತ ಇಸ್ ನಾಟ್ ಟಾಟ್ ಆಸ್ ಅ ಟೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ ಇನ್ ಆರ್ ಹೋಮ್ಸ್. ಸೊ ಐ ವಾಸ್ ಥಿಂಕಿಂಗ್ ವಾಟ್ ಶುಡ್ ಐ ಡೂ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಆಲ್ ವೆನ್ ಚೈತ್ರ ಆಸ್ಕ್ ಮೀ ದ್ಯಾಟ್ ಯುನೋ ಯು ಶುಡ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಬಿ ಎ ಪಾರ್ಟಿಸಿಪೆಂಟ್. ಐ ವಾಸ್ ಥಿಂಕಿಂಗ್ ದಟ್ ಹೌ ಕಮ್ ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ಐ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ನೆವರ್ ರೆಡ್ ಆಫ್ಟರ್ ಐ ವನ್ ದ ಪ್ರೈಸ್ ಫಸ್ಟ್ ಪ್ರೈಸ್ ಐ ಹ್ಯಾಡ್ ನೆವರ್ ಸೀನ್ ದಿಸ್ ಬುಕ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಹಿಯರ್ ಇಸ್ ಎ ಮ್ಯಾನ್ ಹೂ ಇಸ್ ನೌ ಇಮಿಡಿಯೇಟ್ಲಿ ಆಸ್ಕಿಂಗ್ ಮೀ ಟು ಕಮ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಸೇ ಪ್ಲೀಸ್ ಕಮ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಅಟೆಂಡ್ ದಿಸ್. ಐ ವಾಸ್ ಲಿಟಲ್ ಡೌಟ್ಫುಲ್ ಬಟ್ ಐ ಟುಕ್ ದ ಚಾಲೆಂಜ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಐ ಕೇಮ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಐ ಅಟೆಂಡೆಡ್. ದೇರ್ ವರ್ ಮೆನಿ ಥಿಂಗ್ಸ್ ದ್ಯಾಟ್ ಆ್ಯಕ್ಚುಲಿ ಸರ್ಪ್ರೈಸ್ಡ್ ಮೀ ಇನ್ ದಿಸ್. ಫಸ್ಟ್, ಆ್ಯಸ್ ಕಮಿಂಗ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ಅ ಸೈನ್ಸ್ ಬ್ಯಾಕ್ಗ್ರೌಂಡ್, ವಿ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ದಿಸ್ ಥಿಂಕ್ ಟು ಎಕ್ಸ್ಪೆರಿಮೆಂಟ್ ಎವ್ರಿಥಿಂಗ್. ಸೊ ವೆನ್ ದ ಸೆಷನ್ ಸ್ಟಾರ್ಟೆಡ್, ನ್ಯಾಚುರಲಿ ಐ ವಾಸ್ ಸ್ಟಾರ್ಟಿಂಗ್ ಟು ಎಕ್ಸ್ಪೆರಿಮೆಂಟ್. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಮೈಂಡ್ ಯು, ದೇರ್ ವರ್ ಮೆನಿ ರೆಸಿಸ್ಟೆನ್ಸ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ದಿಸ್ ರೆಸಿಸ್ಟೆನ್ಸ್ ಸಮ್ ವಾಟ್ ಟ್ರಿಗರ್ಸ್ ಪೀಪಲ್ ಲೈಕ್ ಮೀ ಹೂ ಆರ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ಸೈನ್ಸ್ ಬ್ಯಾಕ್ಗ್ರೌಂಡ್. ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ಇಫ್ ದೇರ್ ಈಸ್ ಎ ರೆಸಿಸ್ಟೆನ್ಸ್, ವಿ ನೋ ದ್ಯಾಟ್ ಫಾರ್ ಶ್ಯೂರ್ ದಟ್ ವಿ ಆರ್ ಪ್ರಾಬಬ್ಲಿ ಮೂವಿಂಗ್ ಇನ್ ದ ರೈಟ್ ಡಿರೆಕ್ಷನ್. ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ದಿಸ್ ರೆಸಿಸ್ಟೆನ್ಸ್ ಐ ವಾಂಟೆಡ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಐ ಆ್ಯಕ್ಚುಲಿ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಪೆರಿಮೆಂಟೆಡ್ ಆಸ್ ಎ ಸ್ಟೂಡೆಂಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಸೈನ್ಸ್. ಐ ಟ್ರೈಡ್ ಟು ಎಕ್ಸ್ಪೆರಿಮೆಂಟ್ ದಿಸ್ ಆನ್ ಮೈ ಓನ್ ಫ್ಯಾಮಿಲಿ ಪೀಪಲ್, ಲಾಟ್ ಆಫ್ ರೆಸಿಸ್ಟೆನ್ಸ್. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಐ ವಾಸ್ ವಂಡರಿಂಗ್ ಹೌ ಟು ಬಿ ಕನ್ವಿನ್ಸ್ ಫಸ್ಟ್ ಮೈ ಫ್ಯಾಮಿಲಿ ಮೆಂಬರ್ಸ್, ಲಾಟ್ ಆಫ್ ರೆಸಿಸ್ಟೆನ್ಸ್, ಮೈ ವೈಫ್, ಮೈ ಇನ್ಲಾಸ್. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ದೇ ಸೆಡ್, ಹೌ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಯು ಸ್ಪೀಕ್ ಆಫ್ ಅರ್ಜುನ ಲೈಕ್ ದ್ಯಾಟ್. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಈವನ್ ಟುಡೇ ಬಾಲು, ಒನ್ ಥಿಂಗ್ ದಟ್ ಐ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ನಾಟ್ ಬೀನ್ ಕನ್ವಿನ್ಸ್ ಸೋ ಫಾರ್, ಆಫ್ ಕೋರ್ಸ್ ವಿ ಆರ್ ಇನ್ ದ ರೆಸಿಸ್ಟೆನ್ಸ್, ವಿ ಆರ್ ಗೆಟಿಂಗ್ ರೆಸಿಸ್ಟೆನ್ಸ್, ಬಟ್ ದ ರೆಸಿಸ್ಟೆನ್ಸ್ ಈಸ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಎ ಪಾರ್ಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಮೈ ನ್ಯಾಚುರಲ್ ಕ್ವೆಶ್ಚನ್. ಸಮ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಕ್ವೆಶ್ಚನ್ ದಟ್ ವಿ ಆರ್ ಟ್ರೈಂಗ್ ಟು ರೇಸ್ ಥ್ರೂ ಯುವರ್ ವರ್ಕ್ಶಾಪ್ಸ್ ಇಸ್ ದಟ್ ಯುನೋ ಹೌ ಡು ವಿ ಕನ್ವಿನ್ಸ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಹೌ ಡು ವಿ ಕಮ್ ಅಪ್ ವಿತ್ ದ ಆರ್ಗ್ಯುಮೆಂಟ್ ಸೋ ದಟ್ ಯುನೋ ದಿಸ್ ರೆಸಿಸ್ಟೆನ್ಸ್ ಇಸ್ ಅಟ್ ಲೀಸ್ಟ್ ಬ್ರಾಟ್ ಡೌನ್, ನಾಟ್ ಕಂಪ್ಲೀಟ್ಲಿ. ಒನ್ ಥಿಂಗ್ ದಟ್ ಐ ರಿಯಲೈಸ್ಡ್ ಇನ್ ದಿಸ್ ಕೋರ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ವರ್ಕ್ಶಾಪ್ ಇಸ್ ದಟ್ ವೆದರ್ ಆರ್ ವಿ ಫಾಲೋಯರ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ ಸೀಕರ್ಸ್. ಇಫ್ ಯು ಆರ್ ಫಾಲೋಯರ್ಸ್ ದೆನ್ ದೇರ್ ಇಸ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಅ ಪ್ರಾಬ್ಲಮ್ ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ಹಿ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ಶೋನ್ ಅಸ್ ಕ್ಲಿಯರ್ಲಿ ಆಸ್ ಸ್ಟೂಡೆಂಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಸೈನ್ಸ್ ವಿ ನೀಡ್ ಟು ಬಿ ಶೋನ್ ಎವ್ರಿಥಿಂಗ್, ವಿ ಕಾಂಟ್ ಅಕ್ಸೆಪ್ಟ್ ಆನ್. ಹಿ ಡಿಡ್ ಎ ವೆರಿ ಬ್ಯೂಟಿಫುಲ್ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಪೆರಿಮೆಂಟ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ದ್ಯಾಟ್ ಸ್ಟ್ರಕ್ ಮೀ. ದ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಪೆರಿಮೆಂಟ್ ವಾಸ್, ಹಿ ಟೋಲ್ಡ್ ಅಸ್ ಟು ರೈಟ್ ಅನ್ ಅಸೈನ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಆನ್ ಟೂ ಶ್ಲೋಕಾಸ್ ಆನ್ ದ ವರ್ಣಸಂಕರ ದಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಟ್ರೈಂಗ್ ಟು. ಸೊ ರಿಮೆಂಬರ್, ಹಿ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ನಾಟ್ ಜಸ್ಟ್ ಗಿವನ್ ಅ ಸ್ಟೇಟ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಆರ್ ಗಿವನ್ ಅ ಟಾಕ್ ಆನ್ ವರ್ಣಸಂಕರ, ಹಿ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ರಿಯಲಿ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಪೆರಿಮೆಂಟೆಡ್ ಆನ್ ಅಸ್. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಐ ವಾಸ್ in this experiment, I was a part of this experiment where he told us to write the meaning of the shloka that Varna Sankara that he is referring to, and I did not realize on the day of the until the day of the discussion that, you know, that many of us have this problem thing, because we have been, for example, I also wrote as a student of science, so called science, that the meaning, and we also arrived at the same answer that, you know, Varna Sankara means, you know, caste thing, you know, affairs and whatnot. I really didn't not think that, you know, I'm deriving the concepts from these kind of things, unless and until I saw all other the participants of this workshop also had invariably done the same mistake. So this was an experiment that strikes me to say that whatever he is speaking is probably science. And as Vinayak was pointing out, at this day, for this day, I would like to say that there is no other alternate apart from accepting what he is trying to say. If we need to understand Gita, I don't think so there is an alternate. So until an alternate begins, we are forced to actually accept his arguments, and we'll have to move away. One thing that I'm quite sure I want to end is that, you know, there is resistance, but the resistance is coming down, because at the end of the 1 week, I could actually convince my in-law that what they were speaking, this, how do we understand that shloka? In fact, I had a very heated argument with my wife regarding this, and my wife had to bring in my in-law, and finally we all sat together and we together decided that yes, stree should not be understood like this, but it is the way that what Balu was also trying. So people are now there out in the field or out in your own family where they can actually understand the correct meaning of it, not deriving any sources. But there are also people who, our own ancestor or our own family members, who are actually suffering with these kind of commentaries that the Acharya Madhva or the Shankaracharya have given us, and they are trying to move. So there is also rigidity there is also resistance there, but I think so we are trying to move in the right direction. At the end of the day, I just wanted to tell you that, you know, it begs a question that are we followers or seekers? If we are seekers, then this is the theory that I would like to move for now. Thank you.
Thank you, Chetan.